It's the 13th of August, 2013. We are in the Wells Fargo building in Anchorage, Alaska. I'm talking with Charles Anderson. Would you refer Chuck to Charles?
Either one, doesn't matter.
Very good. We're making these recordings as to present a historical record for some time in the future that the public will have access to. Mm-hmm. The intent is to store these in some way that we have yet to determine. We'll figure that out. And they'll be available to the public, like I said. They won't be released without your permission. And we're going to be talking about the past, essentially, everything you could tell me about that. If there's something you don't want to talk about, we can take that off the table, and when we get tired, we're done.
Okay.
So that's it.
Understood.
Very good. And let's begin. Where were you born?
I was born in Kodiak.
And when?
In 1929.
Who were your parents?
My parents, my father was also Charles Anderson, and he came from Sweden. Mm-hmm. In the early 1900s. He married my mother, Nellie. Her last name, maiden name, was Simeonoff, and she was born in Kodiak. And we lived in Kodiak. Actually, we lived on Long Island, which is a few miles away from the island of Kodiak, maybe 10 miles or so. And he operated, I was actually born on that island, and my father operated a mink ranch at that location. And when it came time to go to school, then of course we moved in to Kodiak, and he reestablished his mink ranch in the town of Kodiak.
What was the town like in those days?
Well, you know, that was 84 years ago. And of course, memories fade during that time. But I do remember quite a lot about Kodiak. Back then, you could barely call it a town. It was more like a village. And it was a great place to be raised. I can remember my early years and growing to be a teenager and that sort of thing. It was a great place to be raised because we were always in the outdoors. We were doing things that we enjoyed doing, fishing and, you know, and that sort of thing. But the lifestyle was more along the lines of a subsistence lifestyle, where you either had to grow your vegetables and that sort of thing, and whatever else you wanted to eat, you pretty much got it from the ocean. And so I feel fortunate that I was able to be raised that way. The food we ate was pure. It wasn't contaminated with
whatever they put in food.
Well, you know, they beef, you know, commercially raised beef is pumped full of steroids and antibiotics and vitamins and whatever else, we don't know. But so I was fortunate in that regard, I think. And I think it has also led to me being fairly healthy over the years. But Kodiak was small. It was a commercial fishing village. My father, when he wasn't tending to his mink ranch, he was a commercial fisherman and also a boat builder. There were no jobs in a town like Kodiak or a village like Kodiak, so whatever work occurred or whatever earnings there were from work, you had to find it yourself and either make work or struggle to make a living in some way. So it wasn't a wealthy lifestyle by any means, but in my opinion, it was enjoyable.
So you were there before the military buildup came? Or were you there when the military moved into Kodiak?
I don't remember exactly when the military buildup started, but of course during World War II, I have some recollection of when that war started. And of course, back then there was no television, and about the only source of news then was on the radio. And so we heard about the war, and then shortly after that, of course, the military came, and I don't know if that was the first, excuse me, I don't know if that was the first first military that had arrived or not. I do believe, however, that the Coast Guard was there prior to the World War II. So yes, a large military buildup occurred right during the first part of that war.
How did that change the town? Or how did that affect your life?
Well, you know, in the beginning, it didn't affect my life a lot, I don't believe. I was very young, and of course it brought a lot more people to the town. They were building the base, a large Coast Guard base, Army base, and a Navy base on Kodiak, as well as putting in gun emplacements in strategic locations around the island. So there were a lot of people, a lot of military, and of course the town of Kodiak began to grow.
And did you go to high school in Kodiak again?
I did.
As well?
I did. And so, you know, during that time period, my father died when I was fairly young. I think I was 15 or 16 years old. And I had been commercial fishing with him. He died out on the commercial fishing boat. And at that point, it became necessary for me to look after the family and to work and try to provide for our family. I had a brother and a sister. Sister was 2 years older. And so at that point, my job was to provide for the family and to be working in order to provide for them. So I worked in commercial fishing, I worked on cannery tenders, and I also worked in construction. One of the things that I did do over the years is, I don't believe I was ever out of a job. At a young age, I learned that it was necessary to work if you wanted to exist.
Yeah. So you were working and going to high school at the same time, or did you?
As much as I could.
Yeah.
Yes.
Wow. And so then after you graduated, did you take any of those? What was your full-time work after graduation?
After high school, my work stayed pretty much the same. There still wasn't a lot of work available. I was still fairly young, fairly inexperienced, but I did work construction. Mm-hmm. And I remember the construction company that I worked for, we put in, of course, at that point, Kodiak was becoming a little more modern. And I remember we did put in all of the electrical poles and telephone poles and that sort of thing. That was one of the things that we did. And but I also worked on commercial fishing boats.
Yeah.
That's really all I knew to do at that point.
When did you come over to the mainland?
I served in the United States Army starting in 1950. And I was stationed at Fort Richardson. After I got discharged from the Army, I was convinced that I didn't want to go back to Kodiak. There was no work, I felt, and also I noticed that, well, you couldn't help but notice that there was a lot of drinking, a lot of alcoholism. I couldn't see that as a part of my life, and so by this time, when I got discharged from the military, I had gotten married a year before that. And I married a girl who came from New York to Kodiak as a high school girl. And so we got married after I was in the service for 1 year. And after getting discharged from the military, we decided to live in Anchorage. And that's exactly what we did. We didn't live in Kodiak anymore and had no desire to, really.
So what work did you do in Anchorage after you, what year were you discharged?
I was discharged in 1952.
1952. What was Anchorage like?
Anchorage, you know, for somebody coming from Kodiak, Anchorage is a big city.
Yeah.
You know, and we liked Anchorage. Anchorage is a very, very busy place. my wife and I, we had difficulty finding a place to live for, a young couple. There were so many military here at that time. There was a real shortage of housing. And even if you wanted to, or if you could afford to, go to a restaurant to have a meal out, you had to stand in a line out on the sidewalk. That's the way Fourth Avenue was. No matter what business you wanted to get into, almost 100% you'd have to stand on the sidewalk and wait to get in. So business was booming. And so we lived here. In 1953 then, in 1952, before I got out of the service. Can I stop there for
sure.
a minute? You know, this is not about me.
No.
I'm telling you my story, but this is really not me.
True.
I mean, it's me.
Please do. No, it is about you, because you're the person who saw it. And that's
okay.
That's what we have to go on right now.
Oh, okay.
I can go back and dig up the Anchorage Times articles. But,
yeah, okay.
But, you know, they won't necessarily... I've never read anywhere about people standing in line to get into a restaurant before.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yes, it is about you.
Okay.
Let me just take this moment to adjust the shot a moment. And we're rolling.
When you were first married, when you said you had a hard time finding a place to live, what were your first accommodations as a married couple?
First accommodations was a room in a private home.
Whereabouts?
15th Avenue and G Street mm-hmm. in Anchorage. And then we kind of upgraded after that to another room in a private home. Which was located right close to the Mulcahy ball field, which was located then at 6th Avenue and C Street. And from there we moved maybe once or twice. And then we lived in a home where the Lucky Wishbone now sits. So eventually that property was sold and the Lucky Wishbone was built and we later purchased a home and so on.
So what work did you do after the military?
Well, in the latter part of 1952, I had made application to the Anchorage Police Department for a position in the department. I was still in the service then. There was not a job available at that time, but I wanted to get my application in early. And so the police department was fairly small, and at that particular time, there weren't a lot of job openings. So I think I waited a matter of months after I got out of the service, and I took a job in a service station waiting for the Anchorage Police Department. Well, in February of 1953, I hired on to the Anchorage Police Department. And actually at that time I was living in that house where the Wishbone is now located. And the Alaska State Troopers had an office about 400 feet to the east of that building that I lived in. And I was assigned to the vice squad. Initially, mm-hmm. and I worked out of the Alaska, there was a territorial police then. I worked out of their office, so I had to walk 400 feet to go to work every day.
What attracted you to law enforcement?
Well, I liked law enforcement because I knew when I still lived in Kodiak when I was young, I knew the United States Marshal there. I knew the United States Marshal that came after the original one left, and I had a good feeling about law enforcement. That's something I wanted to do, and I also had a friend that was related to the United States Marshal. And at the same time, one of my good friends in Anchorage here was a member of the Anchorage Police Department before I got on.
What kind of cases did you handle as a vice squad? What was vice like in Anchorage in 1953?
Well, surprisingly, there was a lot of work for the vice squad. The vice squad at that time was comprised of one member of the Anchorage Police Department, one from the Territorial Police, one from the United States Marshal's Office, and one military policeman. And we had jurisdiction all over the territory. We could go anywhere. We could go to Seward. We could wherever we were needed, you might say. And so, yeah, there was prostitution. There was a lot of gambling. And the city fathers and state fathers, you might say, were serious about ridding the state of those kind of activities. And so, as an example, we'd get a call from Seward, and if there was prostitution going on there, which there was. There was the famous Alley B that everybody referred to, and we would go there and make arrests and that sort of thing as a result of their call. So, and the same in Palmer and Ketchikan, other places in the state as well.
Was there much juvenile delinquency, what I guess we would have called juvenile delinquency in Anchorage in those days?
Well, I don't recall it being overly bad. There has always been juvenile delinquency, but no, I don't recall it being out of the ordinary, really.
What were the serious legal problems or criminal problems in Anchorage at that time in your mind?
Well, sexual assault has always been fairly prevalent. Mm-hmm. All through the years. Burglaries, armed robberies, every category of crime was being committed. And of course, with the population being certainly lower than it is today, there weren't as many of those things happening. But at the same time, we didn't have as many policemen out right. on the streets. So it was a fairly busy time for us.
Mm-hmm. How long were you with the vice squad?
I think I was on the vice squad and worked undercover for about 2 years.
Hmm. What was your next assignment?
Well, my next assignment was on patrol duty, and I worked on patrol. And actually, during the entire time that I was on the Anchorage Police Department, I only wore a uniform for about 8 or 9 months out of 28 years or whatever. Huh. And so I worked plain clothes the majority of the time. Mm-hmm. Became a polygraph examiner. And eventually I was a training officer, firearms training officer at one time. I worked in the training academy. I was an instructor in interviews and interrogations. And from that point, I was promoted. You had to pass a written test, oral test, and all that sort of thing, and managed to be promoted up. I served as chief of detectives for a number of years. And and that was an enjoyable position. I seemed to be more accustomed to that than almost anything else, because that seemed where my career was headed.
Right.
And then I served as the deputy chief, and in 1974, I believe it was, I was appointed as chief of police.
That's before unification. there was the Anchorage City.
That was before. No, that was after unification.
It was after unification.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you had the whole borough.
Well, we had the whole borough, and as a matter of fact, during that time period, and of course, you know this already. You know, the pipeline was the pipeline and the oil discovery of oil in 1968, and the building of the pipeline, and I mean, we had a boom going on, a big boom, and we had hundreds, maybe thousands of people come up from the other oil states. You know, oil field workers and people connected with the oil industry. So we had a population explosion. And so during that time period that I was police chief, we also, I believe, took in, we had annexation that happened. All of a sudden, well, I think we also took in Eagle River at that, somewhere around that same time. And I can't pin down the exact dates of those things, but so we had actually the population of Anchorage, I think, doubled during that time period. And we had to run back-to-back training academies because the police department was expanding at the same level the city was.
Yeah.
And so it was a busy time. And of course, our crime statistics went sky high during that time period. And it appeared as though Anchorage would never be the same. But somehow we got through it, and since then a lot of great things have happened.
Were you involved at all with the issues of statehood when we became a state?
I did not.
Yeah.
No.
And what was the kind of the feeling when we became a state? Do you recall anything about a mood among people?
Well, you know, as best I can remember, there were mixed feelings about it. Mm-hmm. My feeling about it was good. Mm-hmm. I thought that, and most of my friends thought, this would be a great thing to have happen. That, you know, I didn't necessarily want to see Alaska or Anchorage or any place in Alaska held back from its potential, and I thought the only way the state of Alaska could benefit and the people of Alaska could benefit is if we attained statehood. And so the feeling, at least on my part and most of my friends, was good. We wanted statehood.
What were some of your recreational activities when you were on the job? What would you and Georgia do for fun when you had the opportunity?
During that time period?
Yeah, during the 50s, early 60s.
Well, practically for my life, I've been an avid fisherman, saltwater fisherman, and I've always had a boat of some sort, including today in Seward. And so we still participate in that. My wife enjoys that activity as much as I do.
Right.
So we go together. I mean, I can't even remember the last time I was on my boat without her. But also, starting in, when I was about 50 years old, I guess it was, 49 or 50 years old, they built the Anchorage Racquet Club. They were in the process of building it. And so I stopped by there while the construction was going on. And there was an opportunity right there to join that club if you wanted to, and so I joined it. My wife said, "Why do you do that? We don't know how to play tennis." And so I told her, "Well, we're gonna learn." And so tennis became an activity that we pursued for many, many years then. And So basically fishing, we built cabins, we enjoyed the outdoors, we built a place at Big Lake, which we still have today, and so outdoors, it was outdoors,
yeah.
Everything we did, yeah.
What were you doing during the earthquake?
What was I doing on that particular day?
Right.
Well, I also got involved at one point in racing hydroplanes. And we'd race these hydroplanes in Fairbanks and down in the Kenai, all over the state pretty much. Big Delta, and here in Anchorage. And on the day of the earthquake, we lived on 12th Avenue and B Street. We had purchased a home there, and I was in the basement of our house when the shaking started. I was actually working on one of those engines. And I mean, the shaking was pretty violent, and I could hear my wife upstairs. Things were falling and making a lot of noise. And I rushed upstairs, and by that time we had two children, our daughter Patty and Charles Jr. And so after the earthquake settled down, and of course there were numerous, what do they call them, aftershocks?
Right.
There were numerous aftershocks that went on and on and on for a long time. But I guess in the first week or so, there were just a lot of big ones, like in the range of 5-point-something magnitude, maybe 6.0 or, you know, something like that. So it was a scary time. But on that day, we smelled gas. There were broken gas lines in our neighborhood. And my first thought was, well, first of all, I knew I was going to have to go to work. I mean, that was... what had to be done, but I wanted to get my family safe before I went in. And so I took them to a friend's house out on the Seward Highway, off of Plant Road. And they didn't have gas out there. They didn't have any smell of gas. Anyway, I dropped them off there with our friends, and then went to work. And we pretty much worked around the clock. And we caught sleep when we could. There were a lot of things going on. And of course, you know, a good part of Fourth Avenue sunk down, and there were a lot of buildings damaged, theaters, schools, and so on. The Government Hill School was one school that toppled down, and of course, it happened on Good Friday, so there were no kids in school. Major damage to Denali School on 9th Avenue and A Street. That's where my kids would have been if it had not been Good Friday. And we were actually in the process of getting our kids ready to take them to a movie. And that movie theater, which was on 4th Avenue, I got to get a drink of water.
The old Denali?
The old Denali Theater,
yeah.
That's the one.
Yeah.
Well, if it had happened a little bit sooner, they would have been in there.
Yeah. But for the police, it was a very busy time.
And we concentrated initially on the Turnagain area because of the structure of the soil out there. A lot of houses went over the bluff and down, and I think mostly it was sand that turned semi-liquid, I guess, with the shaking. And a lot of the houses and streets went down, and from on the upper level you could see these houses that were moving closer to the inlet in various states of disrepair and falling down and so forth. And people were missing, kids were missing, and so we spent a lot of time doing that. And doing search and rescue type work,
right,
in those areas. At the same time, there was a certain amount of pilfering that went on that we had to concentrate on. I remember at one point in downtown Anchorage, some of the military people that came into town to help, they were sent in by the military, and some of them were housed in one of the hotels downtown, and we had to arrest 9 servicemen for pilfering. And that's probably not a good thing to have on the record, so I'm not sure about that.
Yeah. What are some of the interesting cases you dealt with as the detective, chief of detectives? Some of the big cases that would have made headlines at that time?
Well, I guess one that I'll never forget is the Lane Hotel, which was located on 4th Avenue and C Street. It was either a 2 or 3 story building, and during this particular time period, someone was going around setting a lot of fires in Anchorage. We knew there was a firebug on the loose, and we were spending, and this, of course, now was not during the earth. We've gotten away from the earthquake here now. I can't recall exactly the year that happened, but this firebug was responsible for setting a restaurant on fire on Government Hill. He set on East 5th Avenue at about Ingram Street. There was a big, big building. It was made of log. I think it was called Fort Starnes. You may even remember that.
Yeah.
That was burned down. Another building, or another restaurant actually, on Government Hill, and other fires. Mm-hmm. Well, all of a sudden the Lane Hotel started on fire. And one of the things that we were doing was we were keeping track of all these fires. We're taking pictures at who was attending these fires. And hoping that the same guy would be showing up. And eventually he did. And turned out to be an ex-military, discharged from the military at the time. He was the guy that set all these places on fire. Well, the Lane Hotel, 14 people died in that fire. And so I recall we turned the garage at the public safety building into sort of a morgue, and we had 14 bodies in there trying to get them identified and that sort of thing. And so this person that we suspected, he wasn't admitting anything, but eventually he did after a long interrogation. Mm-hmm. And I was involved in that. Eventually he did. The interrogation actually was contested in court because it was long, and it was, they tried to make it seem as though it was hard on him and that sort of thing. Well, as it turned out, we made absolutely sure that he was denied nothing as we questioned him. If he wanted a hamburger sandwich, we got him a hamburger sandwich. If he wanted a drink of water, we get him something to drink. If he wanted a Pepsi, we get him a Pepsi. If he wanted to see his girlfriend, we'd make sure he could see his girlfriend. It just went on and on and on and on. And I think the interrogation went on for like 8 or 9 hours. And so he eventually admitted all of those fires, and his reason for burning down these restaurants was because his girlfriend had worked at, and also he had worked at one of them, and they fired him. But his girlfriend was mistreated at one or two of those restaurants, so he burned those down. So he had his reasons,
right,
for doing these things. And so that was a big case.
Was that before the earthquake? The Lane Hotel, I'm trying to picture it.
That was before the earthquake, I do believe, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How long were you chief of police?
Only about 8 years.
7-4, something. How did the department change during those 8 years? Those are pretty frantic years in Anchorage.
They were frantic years, but you know, during the earthquake, the department doubled in size. They're running, like I said, running back-to-back academies, training new officers, recruiting from the lower 48 in some cases, and we at the same time became a more modern police department. So when the day came for me to retire, I never knew exactly when I'd retire. I knew after 20 years I was eligible to retire with full retirement. But I thought, no, I don't know when I'm going to retire, but someday it's going to feel right. And so I stayed another 7 or 8 years and retired. And I wanted to retire at a good time when there was nothing going bad in the department. Because when I came on the department in 1953, there was a scandal going on in the Anchorage Police Department. Some police officers had stolen money from drunk citizens.
Right.
And so there were several police officers fired during that time period. And that is basically what gave me the opportunity to join the department.
So after you retired from the police department, what did you do then? You don't strike me as a person who just...
No, but I thought it'd be a fairly natural transition from law enforcement to lawmaking. Mm-hmm. So I ran for public office. I was elected to the State House, and I believe that was in 1980 or 81. I served for 2 years. It was relatively easy to get elected because I had name recognition in the community. I didn't have any bad marks on my record. And so after 2 years, I was pretty disenchanted with the legislative process. And I soon figured out, and it didn't take 2 years either, I soon figured out that most people were interested in getting reelected. And if they did anything for the people, it was quite by accident. And so I couldn't see going on in that because I wasn't enjoying it. And so in about 1986, I became involved with Cook Inlet Region Incorporated, CIRI, and which, as you know, is a native corporation, one of the 13 regional corporations. And I've served on that board of directors until now. I'm still on that board. And I served as a chairman up until about a month ago and stepped aside for somebody else to become chairman. And also for about the last 10 years or so, I've been on the board of directors of Southcentral Foundation. I don't know if you know about them, but it's an organization that has roughly 1,600 employees. It's a nonprofit organization that's related to ANMC, the Alaska Native Medical Center. Mm-hmm. And they set policy and that sort of thing for the hospital. And so I've served on that board now for that many years since. Well, probably 12 or 14 years.
Now, you chose to affiliate with CIRI rather than Kodiak when the land claims came through?
Well, in 1971, right. when they passed the act, mm-hmm. and when individual Native people were registering, you had an opportunity to register with any of the regional corporations you wanted to. Mm-hmm. You didn't have to stay with the regional corporation from where you came.
Right.
So in a discussion I remember with my sister at that time, I told her I was gonna register with Cook Inlet Region because I thought Cook Inlet Region would have a better opportunity of success because these regional corporations were given a lot of land and a lot of money. And that money and that land was to be turned into profits so that the Native people could sustain themselves and sustain their educations and that sort of thing. And I told my sister I didn't think Kodiak would be able to do that. And as it turned out, Kodiak did not do very well. Kodiak has done very, CIRI has done very well.
Right.
Yeah.
Was there much excitement in your family when the land claims came through and the idea of joining the corporations? Was it an issue of discussion? Or
no,
was it just
there wasn't much. I was fairly young at the time. And no, we didn't consider that some big windfall. I mean, it just didn't seem like it.
Right.
No. A lot of people were just undecided and didn't know if they wanted to get involved or even bother to register. I mean, there was nothing said that they had to. And so a lot of Alaska Native people didn't register and they got left out.
We're rolling back the clock here again to the 1950s and 60s. Where did you shop? What were the stores like that you went through? Was that all your wife's business?
In the 50s and 60s? Well, in the 50s, what was really more interesting than that was when we lived in Kodiak.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah, what were the stores like there when you were...
You know, there was one grocery store, but you grew pretty much everything you wanted, and I don't think people had a lot of money then. There was a lot of money whenever fishing season was over, and that's when you'd see drunkenness and that sort of thing happening. But there was just one grocery store. And back in those days, you went and ordered your groceries, and then they'd deliver it to your house in a flatbed truck. Hmm. That's the way it worked.
Came in on a boat.
Well, it came in on a boat, yeah. Oh, yeah. About every other month or so, a boat would come in and supply the store. Yeah. Well, but in 1950, there were a couple of stores around, you know, here in Anchorage, but there was an awful lot of shopping that happened, you know, at the Sears catalog and Montgomery Ward's and that sort of thing. But, you know, as Kodiak began to grow after that, of course, then we had all the stores came in, and it was a very, very much a changing time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the roads, I'm thinking in 1953, you had the Glen Highway coming in. How much went south? What was the road system like going south towards Seward?
The Seward Highway went to Seward, all the way to Seward in those days, and it was a rough, rocky road, and it took hours and hours. Actually, in 1953, I believe it was in 1953 or 54, my wife and I made a drive to Seward, just as some exciting thing to do. And it took forever. We drove down and back in one day, which was a mistake. Up north, of course you could drive north and you could actually drive to Wasilla, but from Palmer to Wasilla was a tough drive, because it wasn't paved, naturally, and it was pretty dusty and pretty bad road.
What was Anchorage like to raise kids in? A son and a daughter?
Anchorage was a good place. We lived, like I said, in a house on 12th Avenue, and lived there for quite some time. And it was a good neighborhood. It was quiet. I mean, you weren't in fear as you walked the streets and that sort of thing.
Right.
Crime was pretty well controlled, you know, so even though 12th Avenue today is fairly close to Anchorage, downtown Anchorage,
still a good neighborhood, I think.
Pardon me?
It's still a good neighborhood from what I hear.
It is. Yeah. It is a good neighborhood. It was a great community. We had a good school system. Our kids came out of school, smart kids, and have been successful. And I look upon that part of my life in Anchorage. It was very positive.
Right. And Cook Inlet Regional, I mean, it's gone from some, what was originally just a name to, you know, the large corporate offices right down the corner and business interests all over the place. How can you characterize like their growth, their success? Well, you're on the board, your success.
Yeah, well.
Why have they succeeded when other corporations have not been anywhere near as well?
Yeah, one of the things that that we did right from the onset in CIRI, it was we knew it was critical to hire the right kind of people, the right kind of professionals to work in that kind of an organization, and we recognized also that we had no experience in operating businesses. And so we made it a point to do mergers with other companies or purchase companies that had a stake by a percentage, 51% perhaps. And so we had the good fortune of having people from those organizations to help run it. We recognized right away we didn't have in-house expertise to do that. And so many of these joint ventures that we did turned out very successful. I mean, we haven't batted a thousand on every investment we've made, certainly, but we've made some wonderful investments. And today, of course, CIRI is recognized as one of the successful ones. Yeah. So. And CIRI is moving ahead as we speak. Yeah.
When you look at all the at the current police department with some of the things they have, that firing range out in Jewel Lake and the indoor shooting range and the crime center and things like that, have you visited any of the new police installations we have in town? Or
you mean for the police?
Yeah, for the police.
No, I haven't.
That's all past history?
Well, you know, one of the things that happened after I retired, I don't know why this was meaningful for me, but I went back to the police department later, you know. I think we took a vacation or something, and I went back to see some of my friends and that sort of thing. And when I walked in the door, everybody's saying, "Hi, Chief. How are you doing, Chief?" Well, the chief was there too. The current, right, then chief, was there too. And I thought it wasn't fair to him. Mm-hmm. He is the chief of police. I'm not the chief of police. I was.
Yeah.
And yet, all my friends were saying, "Hi, Chief. How are you doing?" And I was not comfortable with that. And so I made it a point to not visit the police department. Mm-hmm. You know, he had his hands full. He didn't need me to complicate things for him. And so, I guess that's one of the reasons I have never really gone back. I just kind of did not look back, and I wanted to go some other directions in my life anyway. So,
right. Is there anything you have wanted to accomplish that either eluded you because you lived in Alaska or just never had the time to get to?
Well, you know, I'm pretty satisfied with my life, and in looking back, I don't think there is anything in particular that would make my life better today than it is. So I don't have any regrets about things that I didn't do. I don't tend to look backwards anyway,
right.
And so my life is great. My life is wonderful. And yeah, I can probably think of some things I should have done differently, but.
But we've spoken for an hour, so it could probably go on a lot longer. Just a couple of things that I bring up.
I have a question too.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Do you remember a place called Schmitty's out by Eagle River? It's supposed to have been a very dangerous bar. I remember driving by it. I can't remember exactly where it was, but.
No, actually, I don't. I don't know how long ago that was, or if it was in the police service area or not.
No, that may have been it. But a man named Jim Barker served on the Anchorage Police Department about the same time, early 50s, I believe. He later became police chief in Juneau. But,
it wasn't Baker, was it?
Baker, maybe, yeah, Jim Baker. Or Barker. But anyway, I just...
Well, in the 50s, we did have a Jim Baker. I don't know that he went on to be a police chief somewhere.
Then, yeah, that was a Juneau thing, though. Okay, you had a question.
Two topics you might touch on. One, after-hours joints and that kind of stuff. And some people have talked about earlier in Anchorage discrimination and discriminatory practices and that kind of stuff. So we get kind of a mixed bag about experience on that, and I just wondered if you had any illumination for that
piece. So, yeah, those
I used to live around the corner from like an after-hours joint, and everybody knew what it was, and so I just kind of amused that it was there in plain sight, and everybody kind of...
Well, you know, the after-hour joints occurred to me a little while ago when I was talking, and for some reason I forgot to bring that up. Yeah, I knew where they all were. I have been in most of them.
Right.
In one way or another.
Undercover or not. How did they operate?
Well, over the years, you know, Anchorage has changed its bar closing hours different times. And basically too early for some people, I guess. And so these after-hour places would pop up here and there. And they would turn out to be, they'd have full gambling facilities, all the necessary tables and that sort of thing for gambling, and also a full stock bar. And by word of mouth, of course they couldn't advertise, but by word of mouth, people would learn about them, and they'd do a bang up business on most nights, and especially on weekends. And they were usually in a private home somewhere. And there have been after-hour gambling joints in Fairview, Mount, every place in town over the years that I can recall. Mm-hmm. And one of the people that, of course, I can remember most of the people that operated them too. But kind of a notable guy that operated one of them was Johnny Rich.
Johnny,
do you remember Rich,
yeah.
Johnny's Girl, the book?
Yeah.
His daughter wrote?
Yes.
Well, and of course he got killed by some of his friends. But I can remember he had an after-hour place in Fairview, gambling, alcohol, loud music, you know, the whole thing. And I can remember we raided that place one night in the dark of the night. And when we went in, of course, we had to break the door, and we had a search warrant and all that kind of stuff. Had to break the door and go in. And of course, everybody scatters, but they can't get out. They're just scattering wherever. And I vividly remember this little girl sitting, as we came in the door, sitting at the top of the stairs crying. And that was Johnny's.
That was Kim.
That's Kim.
Kim.
That's
yeah.
Kim. Little girl sitting up there, and all the other officers, they went to corral all these people that were going everywhere. And we didn't have a police. We only had two policewomen on the department, and only one was on duty that night. And so I went to comfort the little girl because I didn't want. I mean, here we are, a bunch of big, ugly people with guns and everything else, you know, and she's sitting up there crying, wondering what's going to happen to her, you know, and her father and whatnot. So I called for a policewoman to come in to take her, and eventually she showed up, and then the little girl was taken someplace where she could, you know, could be until her father bailed out and that sort of thing. So yeah, there were these places everywhere. By and large, the professional gamblers, in my experience anyway, were not violent people. Mm-hmm. They had violent people around them, but they themselves were not violent. They were fairly passive people, and I'm talking about the ones that actually ran the places. Right. And I knew a lot of them so well that we called each other by first name, actually.
And then the issue of discrimination, was there a sense of that minorities had faced any discrimination in Anchorage in the 50s that you were aware of? Or?
No, but you know, there, when you're around a group of people, inevitably, and I'm talking about it like a group of policemen or a group of any people, inevitably, at some point, you're going to hear disparaging remarks about minorities.
Right.
I mean, it just happens. And I don't recall that necessarily being pervasive.
Right.
Of course, you'd hear that once in a while. Nobody necessarily would agree with what was said or anything of that sort, mm-hmm. but it'd be kind of like name-calling or something. And of course, eventually, and I don't remember exactly when it happened, but the city of Anchorage established a human rights commission. And of course, then there were a lot more complaints about various city departments. And of course, you know, the police department was always represented in the complaints.
Right.
So, but I don't remember that being really, I don't recall discrimination really being, I mean, like on the police department, as a matter of fact. I guess you're talking about only men or women too.
Well, I'm thinking two things. One is discrimination against Native Alaskans that some people have told me they felt when they were in Anchorage, and then also against Black people, especially during the 50s with the servicemen.
There's still a certain amount of discrimination against Blacks. You know that. I don't know exactly how it manifests itself so much these days, but people get to name calling and that sort of thing. Now, as far as discrimination, as far as housing, employment, and that sort of thing, you hear complaints of that. I'm not knowledgeable about that, and so. The same goes, for the natives. I'm close to the native community here in Anchorage because of my association with the Southcentral Foundation. About 1,500 people work out there, as I said, and most of those are natives. There's still discrimination against natives. The same name calling and that sort of thing. Now, if there's discrimination in housing and employment for natives, I'm not aware of it.
Yeah.
But, you know, as far as employing females in the police department, that was an issue at one time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And before I became chief, we did have two female officers. Mm-hmm. They were assigned duties that seemed to be, at the time, more fitting for female officers than for men. They were juvenile cases, they were bad check cases, non-violent kinds of cases. And when I became chief, we hired our first female police officers to do patrol duty just like any other police officer. And we learned fairly soon after we did that that they were making complaints. Well, first, and this is kind of funny in a way, one of the first complaints we got is there's no locker room for women to change into their uniforms, that sort of thing. Well, we didn't. We were in the old public safety building, which at that time sat at 6th Avenue and C Street. And we didn't have private bathrooms for the women. Mm-hmm. The men, they'd go use the bathroom as men do. But nothing for the women. So we had to change a lot of things, but we did hire them, and they were performing regular patrol duties. Some of them weren't cut out for it. They immediately asked for a transfer, a juvenile or bad checks or, frauds and that sort of thing. They didn't want to work the street, even right. though they fought for it, and wanted it. And I don't think it was a mistake. There are female police officers out there now doing a wonderful job.
Yeah.
But there is also a feeling, I believe, and the reason I say this is on occasion, I'll monitor the police one of the police frequencies. Mm-hmm. And I haven't even talked to anybody about that. I just do it for my own entertainment, you might say, on a busy Saturday night or something. Just to see what's happening, and I can see the officers, the male officers, taking extra steps to make sure the female officers are protected.
Mm.
And that's not exactly a good thing. I mean, if an officer is distracted from what he's supposed to be doing,
mm-hmm.
because a female officer is present, and he has to kind of look out for her, that distraction is not needed there. And I'm not saying the female officer should be fired or anything of that sort. It just is what it is.
Mm-hmm.
They're taking extra little precautions here and there. Like if a car in a particular area, a police car in a particular area is dispatched to a seemingly violent call of some sort, inevitably they'll also dispatch a male officer.
Right.
And like I said, there's no answer to that.
Yeah.
There's no answer to it. It just happens.
Are there other ways that police work has changed in 50, 60 years?
There's a lot of ways. Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. And of course, one of the great guides for law enforcement is what the courts come down with,
mm-hmm.
Cases that go up on appeal and so forth. That sort of sets the tone for what's happening in law enforcement.
Right.
And there's nothing in particular. It's just kind of a slow evolution, you might say. The equipment gets better all the time,
mm-hmm.
The educational standards increase constantly, and so I would say, certainly without question, that the police officers of today are by far more educated and trained to be police officers than those that came out of the 50s and 60s.
Hmm.
No question about that.
I think that pretty well winds up anything I have. So anything you want to add?
No, can't think of anything. No.
It's been a pleasure.
Well,
thanks.
I'm not really that accustomed to this, but.
Neither are we. This
is, do what you can do,
It's kind of a lark for us. Bob's a professional.
Hey, it's a job, isn't it?
Yeah, well, for me, this is mainly fun. I mean, I try to tell people about what Anchorage was like, and they don't believe me. And so
yeah.
Anytime I can find corroboration.
Yeah.
The reason I mentioned Jim was he had the same process. He came to Alaska and worked for a year as a glazer before he could get on with the Anchorage Police Department, and got to Juneau shortly thereafter.
How long ago was that?
Well, I believe he was chief of police in Juneau up and through the 70s. He talked about one time when there was a bear on top of the buildings in downtown Juneau, and they're all kind of connected there. And Fish and Game didn't want to do it because it's in the city, and the animal control didn't want to do it because it's a wild animal, so it comes down to the police to have to try and deal
yeah.
with this black bear. And he goes up on those roofs, and there's all these things sticking up. He can't see a thing.
Yeah.
But except down on the street, the whole crowd is out there. Everyone's poured out of the bars, and they're all standing there. And he can kind of tell where the bear is because everyone's eyes go back and forth. But he still can't see anything.
In law enforcement.
Yeah, he's got his 37.
One of the things that really has changed a lot, and it's the violence that police officers are faced with nowadays. almost all officers that are dispatched to a call almost automatically now they send backup because of the potential for violence.
Yeah.
I mean, we don't have to think very far back, you know, to remember the officer that was sitting out in Fairview in his patrol car and somebody came up and shot him through the window.
Right.
I mean, people are so violent anymore. Mm-hmm. And back in the early days, we didn't have gangs. You know, we started to have gangs. I mean, they didn't just happen. They've been around for a while, but you know, it just seems like they don't think twice and they're using a gun. Yeah. And what this causes is complaints against the police department because the police go in aggressive to begin with. They have to.
Yeah.
In a lot of cases. So one thing leads to another, you know. And I think we're fortunate in Anchorage. We have a very professional police department. We have a good man in charge. And they're highly trained. They have continued training constantly. And only once in a while do you hear of some bad egg within the police department. Of course, we all hate that, but you know, it's part of life too, I guess.
Mm-hmm. You didn't have a lot of training in your day in the 50s. Sounds like you just kind of applied and they took you in and then you wound up training other people.
Well, yeah, like in the 50s, yeah. you know, it was a pretty small department. I think we had like 30 people on the department then. Now we're talking hundreds.
Right.
And when I retired, we're talking hundreds. But, you know, they had a training. They had a training academy.
Yeah.
In the 50s. Nothing like they have today. And the training that occurred then, I suppose, was fitting for the time. But a lot of the training happened out on the street. You were put with a training officer, and you worked alongside a training officer for several months, which was almost much more valuable than yeah. Classroom training. So you did get some experience. Yeah. Yeah, and I can even remember my first call that I ever went on involved a gun. I was scared.
Yeah.
You know. But that's neither here nor there. But
what was the incident?
Well, I was in training, of course, because I was new. And the first dispatch we ever made was to the old federal building down at 4th and F. A man with a gun in the hallway, threatening people. And so the officer that I was with dropped off at the front door. I went around to the side door, which is on the west side of that building. And we went up to the first floor, half a flight, I think it was then. And as I ran down the hall towards the front of the building, this guy with the gun and I crashed into each other right on the corner, going around the corner. And his gun went scooting down. That was my way of disarming him.
Yeah.
So, I mean, when you hear the dispatch say, you know, answer this call, there's a man with a gun. That's not good to hear, really.
The federal building was like the center of town.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
Everything happened there.
Yeah, 4th and C was kind of like between 4th and C and the federal building, pretty much the center of town.
Yeah,
yeah, in the early days, I can't remember when they paved 9th Avenue. That was somewhere in those early days. Yeah.
Now the roads just keep getting better. That is one good.
They do.
Can I throw in a question to you about, I heard once, and maybe you can tell me if you're aware of this in your experience, but that there were beat officers in that South Division and around the 12th that would walk around downtown and look for chimney fires.
Look for what?
Chimney fires in the residences. And if they saw something, like somebody hadn't got their stove damped down or their fireplace camped quite, that they'd actually enter the house because it would be unlocked and they would adjust the fireplace and move on. And this may be going back farther, or the, maybe this is just one person's memory, but I thought with your time in law enforcement, maybe you had any kind of anecdotal connection to that at all.
Nope, doesn't sound familiar at all to me. No.
People in Kodiak, when you were young, didn't lock their doors much, did they?
They still don't.
But in
actually, I know people in Kodiak,
yeah.
And they don't lock their doors.
Yes.
Yeah. I think there's some people here that don't lock their doors, too. But, you know, I mean, there's a ton of cases I can tell you about, but, I mean, this is not necessarily where you guys want to go, I'm sure of that. A lot of funny stuff happens over the years.
Anything specific to those early years that wouldn't be the case nowadays? In other words, something peculiar about a case that had to do with the time and the way the city was at that time, as opposed to something that could have happened yesterday, something that's unique to its time period that stands out?
Well, I know in the 50s, we always had foot patrol out, which we haven't always had since then. We always had foot patrol out. And of course, there were no radio communications in those early days. We didn't have handheld radios and that sort of thing. So if the police station wanted to get a hold of you and you're on foot patrol, how did they get a hold of you? Well, right in the middle of town on E Street, at the top of the traffic signal, there was a red light. And so if you're walking foot patrol, you always had one eye on that traffic signal to see if that red light was on. And if the red light was on, then you're on the phone to find out why.
Did you have to go to a pay phone, or did you have police phones set up?
No, we'd go in and use the phone behind the bar or whatever, you know. And, you know, even back in those days, we had homeless panhandling.
Hmm.
Yeah.
I was curious about the homeless.
And I was just going to say, and most of them we knew. Mm-hmm. We knew them. And one of the things in response to what you just asked that happened back then was public drunkenness was considered a crime. Mm-hmm. Public drunkenness is no longer a crime. It's a social problem, and so you can't arrest them for being drunk.
Yeah.
And we had a prison farm out at Russian Jack Springs. There was a prison farm out there. They grew vegetables. Those prisoners would get sentenced by the court to serve 30 days or whatever, and they'd go out there on that farm and they'd work the fields and that sort of thing. And so then the prison farm moved out to Point Warnsoff in that area. And it was, while it was located out there, the court system decided this is not a criminal offense, and that public drunkenness was a social problem or medical problem. And so, but we even had people come into the police station. Some of these people that were homeless and down and out and so forth say, "I want to go to the farm." They'd come in and ask. And I can remember one case, this guy came in, we all knew him, and it was getting towards fall, it was getting a little cold outside, and he says, "I want to go to the farm." And the officer told him, "Well, you haven't done anything wrong." So he picked up the cash register off the counter, slammed it on the floor, he says, "Now can I go to the farm?" Well, he did. He went to the farm.
Did they ever blue ticket people?
Well, that old that blue ticket system, that went out way years and years before. Yeah. I can only remember hearing about that, you know. But, you know, most of the time, if some of these people that drank and were drunk up and down the streets, as I said, we knew most of them, and they'd come to us and ask for money. If you're walking foot patrol, they come to us and ask money. Well, you give them some money, but what we would do is march them into the restaurant and say, okay, you want a bowl of soup or you want something else? And I'm going to stand here and watch you eat it. See, they wanted it for drinking.
Right.
So that's mostly what we do, you know.
Could you do a quick, simple overview of the blue ticket system? Because I'm not sure how prevalent that knowledge is.
What did they tell you about the blue ticket?
Well, I've only heard about it in the past, and they had a system, as I understand it, where an individual who was considered to be undesirable in the community, for whatever reason, drunkenness or perhaps any other reason, if he was undesirable, he would be provided with a ticket out of town, and usually they were sent to Seattle.
The homeless people or the down and out people in the 50s, were they like the people today? I mean, at least some of the homeless people I know of seem to be preferring to live that way than to be indoors.
Well,
I don't know if it was that.
I think the homeless population in Anchorage has taken on an absolutely different identity, sort of, than what it was way like back in the 50s and 60s. Back then, the people that were homeless were residents. They lived here.
Wow.
Or they were born here. And they were recognizable by most people that knew them, perhaps personally, right, at some point. And nowadays, as you go around and you see the panhandlers and you see the homeless and you see intoxicated people, they're of every nationality, just about. Mm-hmm. So they're not of one nationality. They're different. They come from various places around the country, and they're organized. There was never, back in the early 60s, to my knowledge, any degree of panhandling for money. Mm-hmm. People didn't hold up signs like they do today. Now they seem to be a little better organized, and now, not so much before, but nowadays there are places for these people to go. In fact, I just happened to be at Bean's Cafe within the last 3 or 4 days to make a donation. Mm-hmm. And the people that were congregating around Bean's Cafe, they're of every nationality you can imagine.
Yeah.
That's our homeless population. It's almost to educate yourself, almost worth going there just to see.
Right.
And it's pathetic. Some of them are very, very ill people that don't look like they're long for this world. Others look relatively healthy. Some are completely sober. So there's a variety of them. And unfortunately, you know, the ordinance that was passed that makes it unlawful for panhandlers to panhandle, and also makes it unlawful for people to make donations to them, makes that unlawful. But unfortunately, that's not working. I don't think it's being enforced. And if it was being enforced, I don't know what would be accomplished by it. It certainly does not look good for our city. And we've been unable, as a society, we've been unable to deal with it. There's not fewer homeless people out there, there's more homeless people than ever, I believe.
Any idea what Anchorage is going to look like in the future, another 50 years from now?
I can't imagine. You look back, see what's happened in the last 50 years. No. I can't even imagine. I wouldn't try that, really. No.
Good enough.
You're talking to the future right now, actually, if you think of it that way.
What's that?
So you're talking to the future right now. The folks are going to be watching this.
Oh, well, good luck, people. Well, look where we've gone, you know, with computers and simple things like television and automobiles and communications, all of that. Look, aircraft, everything. I mean, there's no end to the great things that have happened in the last 50, 75 years. And the people, and the young people, I guess, it's, you know, depending on how old they are, they have no idea what's in store for them, unless they make a study of it somehow.
Very good.
Thank you very much.
I think we're...
You're welcome.